Coleman Joiner that played football here was the Coleman Joiner that was, he wasn't a Christian, but he was the one that was trying to fit in. I spent more time here than anywhere else. And so the people that ended up sitting next to me or I played with became the people I spent the most time with. So he was very open to doing a lot of different things just to be a people pleaser. It was a lot of different Colemans. There wasn't just one Coleman. It'd be a different Coleman for each person you talk to. Well, the guy they knew in here, at least from what I know, I mean, I was the guy they at least can count on outside of here, because I wasn't the coolest guy, but I think my relationships were built on, hey, if you need anything, let me know. Hey, if you need me to pick you up, if you need me to take you to this party, I think that's where my relationships were built on. That's who they knew me as someone that was here every day and that they could come to if they needed something, whether it be good or bad. Well, before I became a Christian, I definitely was always around it. I think I was more scared of getting in trouble for doing stupid things. And so I didn't necessarily partake in everything, but I was there. I could say I encouraged it by, like I said, actually taking people to these parties, helping people get what they need to be at this party. I definitely was influenced by it all, definitely was around it and a part of it. And I mean, even if I didn't do everything that everyone else was doing, I was still, you can say guilty by association all the time. That Coleman Joiner went through a little bit of a transformation as well. Since I've been a coach, and when I started to kind of get consumed by it, because there's so much preparation and so much work that you can end up doing if you want to be successful. And so early on I got consumed by it a lot. So I don't know if I was a Christian when I first started coaching, or at least one point in time, I don't think I could have called myself a Christian confidently. Christ wasn't in my focus at all. I do feel like I've maybe found a nice balance, and I hate to say balance because it's not equal. Christ isn't equal to football in my life, but dealing with youth, and it's the same as, it's a great opportunity that I'm dealing with students that this isn't church, and this isn't home, and this isn't church, and so I feel like they're about as genuine as they come when they come in this locker room and they're out on that field. And so the lessons that you can teach there and the opportunities I've had I've gone to church with some of the kids. I've taken a lot of the kids to church. I think being a Christian and being a football coach is one of the most awesome opportunities.
Coleman in high school was a people pleaser, and at times that's a great thing. And at times it makes you do dumb stuff. And I just found myself trying to fit in a lot because I was a part of a lot of different peer groups, but still just kind of pulled into a lot of different situations and drama. But Coleman here was always, he was one that always wanted to fit in. Coleman's main goal every time he stepped foot in this building was to try and be cool. I guess I felt like I had to make myself somebody here. Like, this is what made me especially these 4, when you get to high school, the 4 years you put in here are what's going to make you later on, the type of person you're going to be, the friends you make, the relationships, the girlfriends, the things like that. So my main goal when I stepped foot in here every day was to really just try and experience as much as I can and be thought as cool to as many people as I can. If that meant being mean to anybody, or if that meant to kind of make someone else feel like an outcast, that's what I had to do. I mean, I was the funny guy. I guess I've left that out. I shouldn't have left that out, because I guess I'm not that funny. I was the funny guy. I was always trying to be funny, and there were a lot of people that were the butt of my jokes. And so that did make me come off as a jerk sometimes. There were people that understood my humor and understood my personality and loved it. And then there were people that thought it was stupid and thought I was stupid because I thought it was funny to maybe make fun of something or make fun of somebody just to get a laugh out of somebody. So, I mean, I like to think sarcasm is my love language, but some people don't see it as that. So I hope I've gotten better. It makes me feel really bad. I can say that I've talked to some people since then, and I mean I have apologized to some people since then for some of the things I used to say. Facebook's a beautiful thing, and so I've kind of made a point to apologize and to kind of apologize for my ignorance and my stupidity back then, because it wasn't funny. I can look at it now and it's not funny. I mean, being in the classroom now and seeing people get made fun of like that and be seen, be made an outcast, it's not funny. And just knowing the things that I've gone through, and I mean, when I'm the butt of someone's joke and I'm not feeling the greatest, it sucks.
It was a little strange because as soon as I joined God's Light, I'm now surrounded by the church people. That always kind of scared me. I was never one of those people that were like, oh, church people judge you, but it was always, they were weird. You just knew, like, if you're one of them, then you're known as one of them, and you could get made fun of or whatever. So now I'm surrounded by those people. We sang songs, and I can honestly say I had no idea what I was singing about. I can't recite any lines, any lyrics from the songs. I can't repeat anything that I heard and was like, that was a life-altering moment singing that, or that I felt so empowered by the Holy Spirit getting to share that. I had no idea what I was singing about. It never bothered me because I didn't know. I really didn't know. I didn't know what I was singing about. I just kind of showed up and read the pages. That was it. It was my first, this choir was the first taste I had of the church and of, I guess, Christianity, but I didn't really know it at the time. I knew that there were people who talked about church outside of church and talked about God, but that wasn't, those were the weird ones. To me, anyone that left this room and Jesus was still what they were talking about, I was kind of like, why, we just finished that. We just finished talking about that. Why are you still talking about it? Well, let me just phrase it this way. If there's a kid who doesn't get it and a kid who does get it, I would go straight to the kid who does get it and tell him to make sure the kid who doesn't get it, you make your best effort to help him understand. Because that was one thing I guess I was lacking, was a peer in this group helping me get it. You have an opportunity to be on the same level and still minister to your own peers in your own way. Because the one that does get it, I just tell them to take advantage of the opportunity you have. I mean, to understand that in this group, we traveled around the country, and I didn't understand the magnitude of it until now, but you're traveling around the country and you don't know who you're going to run into that doesn't know the gospel and doesn't know what this is all about. And you're up there singing the truth. You're the speaking parts are all about the gospel and who God is, and you don't know who you're going to run into that needed to hear that or hadn't heard it for the first time. That's the point. It's for the kid who doesn't get it. It's for the people that don't know it. Those are the ones you're here for. And for the kid who doesn't get it, I'd urge you to continue. I believe that the Holy Spirit is going to get, he's going to help you get it when it's time. And I didn't know that then, and I probably got frustrated a little bit when I wouldn't understand it, or I felt like I didn't know what, I wasn't like the other kids that went to church. I just urge you to be prepared for that moment, and to want that moment, if you're here for this reason. It wasn't anything I desired, but I mean,
looking back in hindsight, I mean, it is something I wish I would have had, because you see the joy people find in Christ outside of the church. And so at the time, no, I didn't think anything of it. I thought, oh, well, I've got this friend and he doesn't even talk about God when he's here, and he's still here. And so it just, that was natural for me, and that was normal for me to not think much of God or anything. I mean, I believed in God and I believed there was a God, but I didn't really, it wasn't anything that I was like desiring. There wasn't a burning desire. Heaven wasn't even on my mind. It was just kind of like, yeah, I believe in God, because I was fine without it. I'd found myself here without it, and I thought I was fine. Being able to lead worship in that way by singing in the choir wasn't anything to me, because I didn't know that was our job. I thought it was the people who were listening to the songs, it was their job to understand what we were singing. It wasn't my job to understand what I was sharing. You're ultimately responsible for, like you said, the creating the environment that is worth at least asking why, at least asking questions. Because at the end of the day, you're either creating an environment that someone wants to come back to because they want what you have, or you're creating an environment that someone doesn't want to step foot even near because of what they've experienced around you or around another group. And that can be said within church or any other environment. You're leaving someone with either a bad taste or a good taste. You have a golden opportunity to leave a good taste in someone's mouth every time they step foot in your church, in your group. To me, it didn't impact my future. I couldn't see this catapulting me any other way, but I mean, the longer I stayed in it, and the more God kind of pushed me through it and pushed me into different roles. I mean, this had as much to do with me coaching and me teaching as any other influence in my life. I mean, the relationships I built with the younger students here translated to me wanting to help in the youth group, and then coming to Alpharetta and helping with this youth group, and then wanting to work with students on the football field and wanting to teach students in the classroom. I mean, it can all be traced back this far and probably even further back, but I can honestly say that God saw me on the sideline when he saw me in this seat, and I have no doubt in my mind that he knew where I was going to end up from the first time I walked in this room, even if I didn't even get it. I didn't even understand. I didn't even know him, really. I didn't know God knew my name when I walked into this room. Your future's beginning. I mean, you're getting closer and closer to the future that he's called for you, but not only you, but for this world. We've talked about occupying your own space, and the sooner you start occupying your own space, the sooner you start to impact others. It's an opportunity I wish I would have been able to start before, because I just see how much I've been impacted by being surrounded by you guys and being surrounded by other people and just encouraged. I mean, I'm learning my days are numbered, and the future, we don't know when Jesus is coming back, and we don't know when heaven's coming to earth, and until then, we're called to bring heaven to earth. And I think now, I mean right now, is when it starts. The future begins right now if you don't think it started yet. I encourage you to just ask God to start right now. The future begins right now if you let it. The future without Christ is one that ends. A future without Christ is one that does have a stopping point. A life without Christ is death. A future without Christ is a very short future. A future with Christ never ends and continues to impact people way after we're gone on this earth. I like what John Piper said. If we were promised heaven and all the great things and all the perfection, and God wasn't there, and it was a heaven without God, would we still want that? Or is it God that you want? Heaven is just where you're going to get to spend eternity with him. And I mean, that's something that's just been on my heart, is am I after a future of happiness, or am I after a future with Christ, living like Christ for the rest of eternity?